Thank you. Will Williams, president of Brite Divinity School. It is my pleasure to welcome you to this annual convocation, marking the beginning of Brite's 102nd academic year. Students, faculty, and staff are joined today by trustees, alumni, and friends. To each and all, welcome. Hear now this ancient call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing.
Thank you. love and serve you with mind and spirit. We meet you through study and faith. Open us to your presence among us today and each day, that through our learning and our loving, we might be inspired by you to care for your creation and our sisters and brothers. Christ, Sophia, wisdom, illumine and move us. Amen.
A little more than a century ago, the leadership of Texas Christian University established Brite as a separate corporation to partner with the larger university in preparing leaders for church and world. Now, for more than a century, TCU and Brite have collaborated in this shared mission as vital to the health of life on this planet as it has ever been. It is my pleasure to introduce Chancellor of Texas Christian University, Dr. Victor J. Machine.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. On behalf of everyone at Texas Christian University, I want to welcome you to this new school year. This is always one of my favorite times of the year. It's a time of joy and renewal and commitment. A little bit of trepidation, too. And all biblical things, not themes, now that I think of it. So welcome, everybody, and I wish everybody the best, all the students, the faculty, the staff, and especially the trustees and the friends of Brite. God bless you.
Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people the rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me, and delight to know my ways, as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble ourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fasting and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such the fast that I choose, a day to humble oneself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush, and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to clothe them and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicators shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise from the darkness, and your gloom be like the new day. The Lord will guide you continuously, and satisfy your needs in parched places, and make your bones be strong, and you shall be like a water garden, like a spring of water, whose waters never fail. Your ancient ruins shall be rebuilt, You shall raise up the foundations of many generations. You shall be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of streets to live. The word of the Lord.
As long as someone has a dream in their heart, they cannot lose the significance of living. It is part of the pretensions of modern life to traffic in what is generally called realism. There is much insistence upon being practical, down to earth. Such things as dreams are wont to be regarded as romantic or as a badge of immaturity or as escape hatches for the human spirit. When such a mood or attitude is carefully scrutinized, it is found to be made up largely of pretensions, in short, a bluff. People cannot long to live if the dream in the heart has perished. It is then that they stop hoping, stop looking, and the last embers of their anticipations fade away. The dream in the heart is the outlet. It is one with the living water welling up from the very springs of being, nourishing and sustaining all of life. Where there is no dream, the life becomes a swamp, a dreary dead place, a deep within a person's heart begins to rot. The dream not need be some great and overwhelming plan. It need not be a dramatic picture of what might or must be someday. It need not be a concrete outpouring of a world-shaking possibility of sure fulfillment. Such may be important for some. Such may be crucial for a particular moment of history. But it is not in these grand ways that the dream nourishes life. The dream is the quiet persistence in the heart that enables a person to ride out the storms of their churning experiences. It is the exciting whisper moving through the aisles of their spirit, answering the monotony of limitless days of dull routine. It is the ever-recurring melody in the midst of the broken harmony and harsh discords of human conflict. It is the touch of significance which highlights the ordinary experience, the common event. The dream is no outward thing. It does not take its rise from the environment in which one moves or functions. It lives in the inward parts. It is deep within, where the issues of life and death are ultimately determined. Keep alive the dream, for as long as a person has a dream in their heart, that one cannot lose the significance of living.
Morning, grace and peace. For the last several weeks, I have longed for this day. This day that marks the beginning of another academic year, and just to be clear, I have longed for it not because of my interest in providing an address for the beginning of the fall semester. Rather, I longed for it because of my interest in being surrounded by people whose dreams resonate with writers like the one who penned Isaiah's vision in chapter 58. This iconic passage reminds me of the justice-seeking and justice-making God who requires of us participation in the vision, not as bystanders, but as genuine actors. Yet, as may be the case with many of you, this summer I found myself weary as I faced the daily chore of promoting God's justice in the midst of escalating violence. Let me remind you about some of the summer's reality. For all of the past academic year, many of us at Brite reflected on and participated in the discourse and events that gave new meaning to Black Lives Matter. Then, in early June, we were stunned and grieved when a white gunman entered a church Bible study in Charleston, South Carolina, killing 9 African-American pastors and laypersons. The Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church will never be the same, nor will any of us who bore witness to the tragedy and the surrounding controversy about whether the Confederate flag should still fly over the state capitol in South Carolina or anywhere else. Yet many of us were bolstered by the courage of Brittany Newsom, who climbed the pole and removed the flag when the lawmakers struggled to act in justice-seeking ways. And almost immediately, there was an increase in church fires targeting African American congregations. congregations, particularly in the South. In the midst of the smoke, it was challenging for me to see Isaiah's vision of God's justice-seeking people who helped loose the bonds of oppression. At about the same time, in late June, the Supreme Court ruled that same-gender-loving partners could legally marry in the United States. Good news. Creating a way forward after years of indecision and setback. And while this was indeed a moment of incredible significance, it is also true that the changes unleashed a host of religious freedom laws intended to protect those whose religious stances do not support marriage for two women or two men. I found myself wondering again, how long, O Lord, before love really does win among God's justice-seeking people? Then in mid-July, Sandra Bland, a young African-American woman on her way to a position at her alma mater, Prairie View, Texas A&M, was stopped for not signaling the change of lanes. According to eyewitnesses, Officer Insignia demanded that she get out of the car and physical fight ensued, which resulted in her imprisonment in the Waller County Jail, where she was found hanging to herself a few days later. Local pastors and others committed to the embodiment of Black Lives Matter continue to witness at the county jail, seeking justice for Sandra Bland and many others. And now this past weekend, we find ourselves reckoning with the death of a police officer in Houston. And I keep wondering if we will ever know what justice looks like without guns and violence. And in late July, a federal judge determined that the detention centers that house largely Latino children and families in places like Dilley, Texas, were not meeting legal standards. These for-profit centers function like prisons, and they were deemed inadequate for those whose lives hang in their balance. Meanwhile, across the globe, migrant communities are seeking safe sanctuaries by traveling across seas and oceans in boats or in trucks across borders. The loss of life is significant, and the upcoming political election seems to spark vigorous debate about what it means to be a foreigner or a stranger. What does justice look like for those whose skin is brown or black and whose accents differ in particular ways? In August in San Antonio, the Jewish congregation Radfai Shalom was targeted by hate speech and vandalism. Anti-Semitic slurs were written on cars and in a memorial garden where spray-painted swastikas and signs of the KKK were prominent. Not enough justice seekers emerged with anger, hurt, despair, and the intention to challenge the status quo of white Christian privilege. Finally, in mid-August, Shay Schuler, transgender woman of color, was murdered in Dallas. Shay Schuler was the 13th known transgender murder victim in 2015 in the United States, with African-American transgender women representing the largest percentage of those murders. Continue to wonder how racism and sexism create nexus points for genderized and racialized violence, and when justice will come. The stories, along with many others, perplexed our summers. As I watched my Facebook and news feed this summer, there were so many daily microaggressions to my soul, often culminating in the escalation of public hate, fear, and violence, that I wondered at times how any of us keep on keeping on. As I joined the laments around me, I began to long for the semester to begin again at those papers that I wanted to grade so clearly. But I was certain that the embodiment of this community we call Brite might find ways to continue conversations, to sustain actions of justice, and to invest in the kind of scholarship justice practice for which we are known. I long for your return, because I hope that the best of our collective minds, intellects, and spirits might nurture the practices of seeking justice through our scholarship and our actions. Although now perfect, and certainly with human failing, I still know Brite to be a place where theologically questioning people show up day after day as students, staff, faculty, alums, and guests. Together we embody something that psychologists have come to describe as grit, a great term. In the face of escalating racism, heterosexism, genderism, classism, colonialism, and more, Brite keeps asking hard questions, interrogating easy answers, acting thoughtfully and intentionally in our classrooms, writings, and public discourse. These efforts take genuine grit, courage, persistence, and passion. Professor Angela Duckworth, a psychologist from the University of Pennsylvania, and her colleagues suggest that grit is one of the most single significant factors in determining the ability for some people to thrive in the midst of adversity. They define grit in this way: perseverance and passion for long-term goals. Grit entails working strenuously toward challenges, maintaining effort and interest over years, despite failure, adversity, and plateaus in progress. The gritty individual approaches achievement as a marathon. His or her advantage is stamina, whereas disappointment or boredom signals to others that it's time to change trajectory and cut losses. The gritty individual stays the course. In a parallel fashion, then, one might suggest that the gritty institution is one that keeps on encouraging and producing justice-seeking scholarship among its constituencies in the face of a culture and church that too often looks for simple and tweetable answers to some of the most challenging systematic problems of our communities, culture, and world. Our scholarship shows up in sermons and prayers, articles and papers, books and monographs, presentations and lectures, marches on the street, in every place where Brite constituents are among the gathered. This notion of grit points to a reality that is reflected in the reading of Howard Thurman. I believe the attribute that Duckworth and her colleagues are measuring includes the dream of the heart about which Thurman wrote and through which he lived. Thurman's dream was rooted in the God and the people of the God who seek and work for justice. Thurman reminds us that the dream does not have to be some great and overwhelming plan that lives large. Rather, the dream has to be nurtured in the heart and spirit in ways that cumulatively make a difference. Thurman says, "The dream is the quiet persistence in the heart that enables a person to ride out the storms of churning experiences. It is the exciting whisper moving through the aisles of the spirit, answering the monotony of limitless days of dull routine." Sounds like the end of the semester. It does not take its rise from the environment in which one forms or functions. It lives in the inward parts, it is deep within, where the lives and issues of life and death are ultimately determined. It takes ongoing practice of grit to be a person or an institution that persists and believes in God's dream of justice in the face of such incredible atrocities. The question for us in this moment is not whether we have the right dream or a dream big enough to change the world. Rather, the question is, how do we nurture a dream that gives us the passion and persistence to keep working for justice when, in reality, it sometimes seems wiser to just simply sit down and give up the hopes that someone else has a better answer? Yet, how do we, as the Brite community, nurture the grit that is needed in order to continue to be a place of justice-seeking scholarship and justice-making practice? I want to suggest four practices that I think are essential in order to sustain our grit-filled activities and our thinking. First, we must affirm and celebrate the fact that we are called as a community of scholars, teachers, and learners, one and all, who bring the best our minds and spirits, our souls and intellects, into conversation with one another, as well as with our literal and figurative neighbors. Every person who sits in this chapel contributes to collective scholarship. Whether our practice shows up in the context of church or congregation, seminary or street. More importantly, I hope that we are a community that takes seriously the diverse perspectives of colleagues and peers, as well as strangers and friends. I invite you to draw on one another's experiences, to ask questions of your own scholarship, as well as of the scholarship that you engage in classes and conversations and in the broader public. Ask, for example, who is best served by a particular perspective? Or how does a particular voice carry embedded tones of racism or white heterosexual privilege? Continue to redefine the terms of justice as a community so that we do not confuse it with other systems of power, such as legal or judicial systems. Nurturing our community and the scholarship and practices that arise in this place takes a certain kind of grit as we keep asking probing questions of ourselves, our scholarship, and of one another. Second, I invite you to genuinely engage in issues that are not personally yours. For example, it is easy for me to talk about the privilege that exists in heterosexism. I know it well and can engage others in reflecting on issues of justice and the ways in which I think justice-seeking people might re-examine our biases about couples and families and sexuality. But it is more challenging for me to constantly be aware of my own racism and classism, because I benefit from those particular structures in ways that serve me well. But without serious engagement, it is too easy for me to ignore my participation in structures that kill souls and lives. If I do not pay attention to what it means for me to be a white person in this culture, I collude in the right kind of racism that destroys individuals and communities. My scholarship can never be driven by one personal issue. When I expand the horizons, I begin to understand how all systems of power and privilege are deeply interconnected, and how much together they violate norms of justice that rest deep and at unconscious levels. Grit requires that we expand our horizons, our visions, move out of our comfort zones in order to seek the broader realm of God's vision. Third, justice-seeking scholarship requires that we engage in conversations with the assumption that the encounter with an other might actually change or transform us in some significant way. I like it better when I just know that I'm there to convince you of something I already know. However, genuine conversation requires that openness to be changed in some small way. For example, in a few weeks, we will begin having a conversation at Brite about how we want to respond to the new Texas laws related to carrying guns on campus. As you know from emails, TCU is working on this process as well. I welcome this opportunity to talk not simply about whether we want people to carry guns on our part of the campus or in Live Rock Village, but I want to have open conversation and to hear perspectives that are not my own, because I genuinely believe that civil discourse about the role of guns and violence in our culture has to occur in every church and community if we are to change the tide of death and destruction resulting from gun violence. I invite you into these conversations with a sense of theological openness. It's not that I don't have an opinion. It is that I want to listen deeply to the experience of others so that I better understand the complexity of the issues and can more faithfully participate in the leadership of this institution as we collectively respond to this issue. For me, discourse embodies justice-seeking scholarship and practice. And finally, I want to remind us that there are many ways in which the best of our minds and intellects, spirits, and beings participate in justice-seeking, justice-making scholarship. I want to encourage us to value the multiplicity of agency that co-creates scholarship and practices There is not one way to be faithful in the world, but there may be some ways that are more honest than others. Thurman, for example, participated in the civil rights movement of the 60s differently than Martin Luther King Jr., yet they were colleagues. One was not right while the other was wrong. Rather, each built on the gifts and graces each one had, in ways that together make a difference in the world. And so I invite you to claim your being, your gifts, for investing in the kind of scholarship that constantly asks questions about justice and righteousness, developing and encouraging practices that break down stereotypes and alter perceptions of foreigners and strangers among us. Together, I invite us to move into the world in multiple ways, seeking and doing justice, while bringing the best of our minds and spirits to this task. It was a long summer of violence, despair, and fear. Even as love won in important moments, there is still way too much fear and hate left in the world. I longed for a return of those of you who sit in these pews, because I know that I am a better thinker and actor in the world when there are people around me who push me to think deeper, broader, more deconstructively or reconstructively. Like many of you, I suspect at times I grow weary and I wonder how long, oh Lord. I feel restless and impatient with myself when I miss my own biases or fail to act justly in the world. I grow tired and I wonder if all the energy that goes into conversations and discussions and actions will actually change the world. But at those moments, I take a breath and I rest. And then I literally turn to look at those who surround me day in and day out. I look at colleagues, teachers and scholars, students and staff, guests and visitors who walk through our doors. And I find deep within us the dream and the grit that is needed for justice-seeking and justice-making scholarship. The grit that we need in order to live into the vision of God's shalom. May it be that way for us as we move into this season. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Let us stand together and sing.
Oh,
to offer this tribute to Professor Emeritus, the Reverend Dr. Marcus Bryant, a Disciples minister who served for 24 years on Brite's faculty from the fall of 1967 to May of 1991. Marcus served on the pastoral care and counseling faculty with Dr. Charles Kemp. He died in December 2014 at the age of 90. I learned of Marcus' death as I sat in my office, the Bryant office, in Harrison Hall, a constant reminder of his service and the generosity of Marcus and his wife, Jean. Marcus' life included an amazing array of experiences. The son of a disciple's pastor, his childhood and that of his three brothers was shaped by the relentless effects of the Great Depression that began when he was age 5. One of his brothers died in World War II in the Pacific. Marcus was a combat veteran himself who served in a unit recognized for meritorious service. After the war, he studied at Lynchburg College, served a congregation in Virginia while he waited for college graduation, and then went to Union Seminary in New York City and Teachers College to get an MA in Christian Education with a dual program of those two fine schools. He was at Union, of course, when faculty such as Reinhold Niebuhr and Paul Tillich were there. He served a congregation near New York City while in school, and it became clear to him that year that he was indeed called to ministry. With his first master's in hand, he enrolled at Lexington College of the Bible, where he also had the good fortune early on to meet Virginia Stevenson, who we now know as Jenny Bryant. This means that he was the son and son-in-law of disciples and pastors. It's a good thing he chose ministry for a career. From Lexington, he went on to serve with the Reverend Dr. Charles Kemp at First Christian Church in Lincoln, Nebraska, where Marcus also completed his PhD in educational psychology at the University of Nebraska. He then served on the faculty at Drake in Christian Education until he got an invitation to come join his former colleague, Dr. Charles Kemp, now Professor Charles Kemp, on the faculty at Brite, because he needed a colleague to help the new program in pastoral counseling and the newly accredited pastoral care and training center at Brite to thrive. It is hard to convey adequately the energy and creativity that was the context for Drs. Kemp and Bryant in the late 60s and 70s especially. They were at the ground floor of the beginning of what we now know as the field of pastoral counseling. Of course, the history of pastoral care stretches across millennia, but pastoral counseling was part of the emerging juncture of two young fields, psychotherapy in a more popular form than Freud could ever have dreamed of, and pastoral counseling. In 1964, the American Association of Pastoral Counseling formed. And in 1967, the Pastoral Care and Training Center at Brite was one of the first approved centers in the country. It provided a much valued location in Fort Worth and really in the Southwest for ministry students and pastors who wanted to develop in-depth skills for effective care with parishioners. Brite was the only seminary in the region that chose to make this new focus in ministry available. And the center quickly added further distinction to the Divinity School. Only later did changes in insurance regulations and reimbursements begin to undermine the viability of the center's programs for training and low-fee pastoral care and counseling for those in need of those services. Dr. Bryant's 24 years helped to solidify Bryant's strong reputation for its programs in pastoral theology and care. Dr. Bryant focused his teaching and writing and research on helping students to develop skills for effective care. One of his three books was titled The Art of Christian Caring. It was an exploration of the writings of C.S. Lewis and the Apostle Paul that, for Marcus, disclosed the power of God's love as a healing foundation for skill practice of pastoral care. His scholarship reflected his gentle and resilient and optimistic way of being. Maybe he had some of that grit that Dean Marshall was describing. Some of his students and colleagues have told me that Marcus was known as a faculty member who always prioritized attention to the
lives of students. He made time to listen deeply to their hopes and dreams and challenges, standing with them in difficulty and ready to offer encouragement. In helping me to prepare these remarks, Ginny Bryant loaned me a copy of Marcus's memoir, My Stream of Time, in which he wrote for the family. It's striking to see that he offered to students and mentors what mentors all along the way had offered to him. Again and again in his memoir, he described the ways conversations with faculty and clergy mentors helped him to find direction for next steps and hope for taking those steps. It's clear to me that when he came to Brite, Marcus was intent on being just that sort of faculty mentor for his students. When I met Marcus and Ginny in the summer of 2005, they immediately began to tell me of their enthusiasm for a program called Friendship Force International that includes hosting international visitors and then the possibility of traveling yourself to be hosted. This program was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize in 1992, which signals its core commitments to enhancing peace and shared understanding. Some of these exchanges are described in Marcus's memoir, where he says they prompted opportunities for him to rework feelings shaped by his war experiences in Europe and his brother's death in the Pacific. It struck me that Marcus never stopped reflecting on the healing and transforming power of God's love. Thanks be to God for Marcus Bryant and his service to Christ Church and to Brite Divinity School.
And thank you, Dr. Ramsey. Ginny Bryant is here this morning, as she has been in so many years past, seated toward the front next to my spouse. Maybe you'll have a chance to greet Ginny as we enjoy our worship. What a pleasure it is for me, as we begin this academic year, to introduce our Luce International Scholars for the fall semester. My Nereo Arce, Professor of Theology and immediate past president of the Evangelical Theological Seminary in Matanzas, Cuba, and Patricia Ares, Professor of Psychology at the University of Havana. Dr. Arce is teaching a course titled German Bookman and the Contextuality of Doing Theology, a critical dialogue from our respective contexts. Dr. Ares is co-teaching with Professor Ramsey the course Families in Cultural Contexts, Implications for Pastoral Practice. Dr. Ares, husband and wife, would you please stand and receive our greeting? Officer for West Texas and all of the Western United States. Glad you could be here today. Anthelia Whitworth, Administrative Assistant in the Soul Repair Center. Colleagues, would you please stand and receive our greeting? Church, the Academy, and public life. as witnesses to God's reconciling and transforming love and justice. Trustees are responsible for oversight and support of that mission. This year, we also welcome three new members of the Board of Trustees. Keith Argan Brite is director of the Moncrief Cancer Institute in Fort Worth, a nonprofit community-based cancer center that integrates research and science from UT Southwestern Medical Center. He is also an associate professor at UT Southwestern Medical Center and chief of the Division of Community Health Sciences. Tim Stevens is a retired physician and an active servant, leader of the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. As a physician, he served in the U.S. Army Medical Corps at Fort McClellan, Alabama, held staff positions at Ben Todd Hospital, Houston, the Nashville VA Hospital, where he was chief of cardiology, Brackenridge Hospital, Austin, where he was director of internal medicine education, and several positions at the John Peter Smith Hospital in Fort Worth. Cuba Webb has worked outside her home as a seismological draftsman and has been active in church and community organizations ever since locating in Fort Worth in 1955 with her late husband, Ted. She currently serves on the Women's Health Council at Baylor All Saints Hospital and is an active member of All Saints Episcopal Church. All three of these new trustees are here today. I'm going to ask them to stand and receive an expression of our appreciation for their service.
Brenda earned a BA from California Baptist University. Logan Fraser. Logan earned her BA from Tarleton State University. Nick Hamilton earned a BS from Texas Christian University. Tyler Heston. Tyler earned a BLS from the University of Memphis. Jenny Wong. Jenny earned a BA from Sundance Sound University, an MTS and a THM from Brite Divinity School. Marcy Irwin. Marcy earned a BS from Oklahoma State University and an MACS from Brite Divinity School. Jared Jaggers. Jared earned a BA and an MA from East Texas Baptist University. Nick Kutz. Nick earned his BA and BS from the University of New Mexico. Zachary Langer. Zach earned a BA from Texas A&M University. Lori Mack. Lori earned a BA from the University of Houston and a JD from Thurgood Marshall School of Law. Liz Long. Liz earned a BA from St. Edward's University. Shane Mushanka. Shane earned a BS from Southwestern Christian College. Matt Parchita. Matt earned his BA from the University of Incarnate Word. Jonathan Rogers. Jonathan earned a BS from Oklahoma State University. Christy Rogers. Christy earned her BS from Rogers State University and an MHR degree from the University of Oklahoma. Tim Schaefer. Tim earned a BA from Boston University. Brandi Scholl earned her BS and MA from Texas Women's University. Ja'Cory Smith. Ja'Cory earned a BSW from Philander Smith College. Joey Stewart. Joey earned his BBA from Baylor University. Betsy Sturbins. Betsy earned a BA and a BS from Kent State University. Don Tatlock. Don earned a BBA from Texas Christian University. Kevin Toth. Kevin earned his BA from Martin College. Wayne Walters. Wayne earned a BA from the University of North Texas. And Kelly Whaley. Kelly earned her BA from UT Dallas. Entering the MTS program, Matthew Roach. Matt earned a BA from Baylor University. Jonathan Sauter. Jonathan studied the Pennsylvania Faith Builders educational programs. Jeffrey Schuhl earned a BA from Nazareth College. Keith Whitty earned a BA from the University of Central Arkansas. And entering the MATM program, Linda Barnett. Linda earned her BS from Middle Tennessee State University, a BA from Belmont University, and her MLS degree from Texas Women's University. Scotty Crawford earned his BS from Texas State University. Barbara Dunlap earned a BS from Texas Christian University and an MA from Texas Tech University. David Hood. David earned a certificate in spiritual direction from Perkins School of Theology. Tiffany Robinson. Tiffany earned her BS from Texas Christian University. Adam Stockton earned a BS from Ashworth University. During the THM program, Jonathan Green earned a BA from Houston Baptist University and an MDiv from Brite. Eve Morrell earned a BA from Texas Women's University and a Master of Divinity degree from Brite. Bobby Cates earned a BFA from the California Institute of the Arts and his MDiv from Brite Divinity School. Bryce Null earned a BA from Lubbock Christian University and an MDiv from Hardin-Simmons University. And Alexandra Oliveros earned a BTH from Baxter University and an MA from Abilene Christian University. We have a number of students entering the DMIN program. I'll read their names, though a number of them are not yet here. They come to the intensives, but I want you to know their names. Lionel Bailey, Ann Eitzel, Sheila Carolla, Kristen Dolly, David Grable, David earned a BA from Baylor University and an MRE and MDiv from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. Daryl Horton, Robert Michael Love, and Mary Wilson. Finally, Mike Brite Chapel, all entering the DA. Entering the doctor, the PhD program, Camilla Paul Sharp, Corey Kachiniak. Corey earned a BA from Smith College, an STM from Boston University School of Theology, and an MDiv from Harvard Divinity School. Ruth Schulenberg. Ruth earned a BS from Northwest Christian College and an MDiv from Emmanuel School of Religion. And Marcus Shield earned a BA from University of Houston, MTS from Southern Methodist University, and a THM from Dallas Theological Seminary. Finally, we have a number of special and community audit students we'd also welcome to the community and like to recognize by name today. Mark Harvin, Kathy Bowser, Robin Brake, Paula Harris, Elizabeth Lockhart, Sue Lowry, Zena McAdams. Zena earned a BBA from UNT, an MDiv and THM from Brite, and a DNIN from Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary. And Sue McDougall. Sue earned a BA from Oklahoma State University and an MDiv from Andover. Rosemary Redmond, Sari Rosario Fierro, and Fabian Theobos. For everyone in the Brite community, welcome, students, and Godspeed.
Convocation Day, the wonderful blending of relationships that find themselves in this chapel today. New students, returning students, faculty, staff, alumni, friends, spouses of faculty and former faculty. We have several that are here to celebrate on this day. It is a powerful witness for us to gather as a community to be here in this place to celebrate the beginning of an academic year. I'm reminded of the hymn, Restless Weaver, that says, "Restless Weaver, ever spinning threads of justice and shalom." As we look at the names of groupings of people, of faculty, staff, students, trustees, alumni, friends, the restless weaver threads us together to allow us, to allow Brite to be a place of significance and faithfulness. You will see there are two responses in your program, and the responses are meant to be a dialogue with one another in the chapel. Those that are returning will stand first and give their response. I invite you, when it's time for you to stand, to turn and face those that are sitting and share your response to them. And those that are new, when it's your chance to stand and respond, if you will turn to those that are returning as we share in dialogue with one another. So I ask current faculty, staff, students, trustees, alumni, friends, if you will stand as you're able and respond to those that are new to the Brite community. We welcome you to Brite Divinity School and invite you to join us on a continuing journey toward transforming scholarship, justice, and practice. We challenge you to develop our gifts and graces for service and to use them on behalf of others. We encourage you to join us in building a community of mutual support, social solidarity, and faithful obedience to the one who blesses us. to those that have been a part already of the Brite community. We rejoice in the invitation to become a part of the life of Brite Divinity School and commit ourselves to doing our part to create a community that treasures learning, values service, and witnesses God's inclusive love. With God as our helper, we will strive to be bright, a place where people are transformed by the renewal of their minds and prepared to pour themselves out for the sake of the world.
through study and interaction to gain wisdom and understanding, trusting the one who blesses you and calls you to serve. Amen.
Amen.